very much for having me. So this might be a bit different for some people, and what I'm going to do is start with a bit of an overview about what this crazy thing called ethical investment is and also why it might be commensurate with actually achieving good investment performance. You know, I've worked in responsible investing for most of my career. The very first thing I did, funnily enough, was I was the tobacco and gaming analyst at UBS. So I feel like I'm quite well qualified to actually talk about ethical investment, but rest assured I didn't stay there for long. First, I have to say that this is general information only. It doesn't take into account your individual investment objectives, financial situation or needs. Please refer to the product disclosure statement and consider getting financial advice. Okay. So just onto the first slide. It's certainly amazing the way this sector is growing in leaps and bounds. Here are a few stats. About 9 out of 10 people in Australia expect their super or other investments to be invested responsibly and ethically. 7 in 10 Australians would rather invest in a responsible fund rather than one that simply maximises financial returns. But as I pointed out, we'd like to try and do both. And 4 in 5 Australians would consider moving their super to another provider if their current fund is not consistent with their values. And I think that's one of the reasons why our particular fund is growing very strongly, even if all these people don't actually act on their good intentions. Certainly amongst younger generations, we're seeing a lot more interest, and that's one of the reasons why you're hearing these words around ethical investing and ESG being talked about a lot more when, I guess, historically you might not have heard them that much in a typical investment landscape. So what is ethical investment? We'd like to think of it in three broad categories. You know, I guess in the very largest circle, you have all types of investment, which doesn't really take into account ethics or where your money is going from a sort of personal ethical view at all. Secondly, you have these funds that, and increasingly quite a few funds would now fall into this bucket where they say, look, we're trying to maximise your returns, but we're also thinking about some of these environmental, social and governance factors, often from a risk perspective. And finally, we have what you call core responsible investment. And that's really the part of the business that our firm is dedicated itself to. And I think that's where you find some of these principles really heavily embedded into the investment process. And, you know, we would define that as screening investments, in our case, according to our ethical charter, doing positive screening, sustainability-themed investing and impact investing and looking at broader community impacts. Within that space, you know, we've seen funds grow up to around $65 billion in Australia. And you can see that, you know, the rate of growth there has really taken off. So it's a very exciting time for our company. We're seeing a lot of money come into the funds and a lot of interest in what we're doing. So just, you know, in terms of the next slide, I'll just give you an idea of how we do this. Probably a little bit uniquely, we've had a charter that sort of guides our ethical framework, and that's a real backbone to our organisation because, as you can imagine, no particular company is all good or all bad or meets every single person's definition of an ethical company. So these are very useful principles for us when we're going and looking at companies through time, looking at the decisions they're making and trying to assess whether we actually think, you know, on balance, they're appropriate for our investors and for our investment universe, which defines itself as ethical. Importantly, you know, this is not just about screening companies out. We really spend a lot of time trying to find emerging companies in new areas. And that's something that I think it's quite hard to do in Australia because, you know, we've got a very big mining sector. We've got an index that's really dominated by the miners and the big banks. And so, you know, although, you know, a lot of people might say, oh, you know, we're an ESG-themed fund, it actually takes a lot of effort and a lot of resource at the smaller end of the market cap scale to actually identify these new opportunities. And often it takes some specific expertise in areas like tech and like healthcare. At the same time, we do actively screen out things that we don't think are appropriate. And, you know, some of the obvious things there are things like weapons, tobacco. We don't really have a tobacco sector in Australia anymore, gambling and so forth. In terms of our investment process, the way it starts is really with that question. When we look at every single company that comes into our overall universe, does it create positive impact? And it sounds like a simple question. In practice, we've got a dedicated team of three people who spend all their time meeting with different layers of company management teams to really assess how engaged these particular people are and how important these sort of issues are to the company and what are they actually doing about them. As discussed, we also take into account is the company's product or the way they're conducting their business doing any obvious harm that we can identify. Those things get weighed up. There can be some discussion and different views coming into that discussion within the firm. And finally, we come up with the universe that we think is appropriate and that is aligned with our investors' objectives. Once we have that universe, we look very, very detailed fashion from a bottom-up fundamental financial analyst perspective at those companies, and at that point we're really just trying as an investment team to get the best returns for our investors and members. And so it's really important to point out that this is not just about buying companies that we think are doing good or doing sort of charitable-based activities. At the end of the day, we are custodians of assets, and we have to invest in a way that we think is also appropriate and going to meet our investors' expectations around financial return. So the companies we invest in really have to meet those two criteria, being both ethical alignment and also the ability to outperform. Our investment process itself, a few things I think that make it different. Obviously, like a lot of people, we're doing very fundamental bottom-up analysis. I think that the nature of our client base and also the sort of style that we're talking about here lends itself to very long-term investing. We're certainly prepared to back companies over a long period of time, and you can see that in terms of the turnover of our fund, which is quite low. One of the distinguishing things is we don't actually try to analyse everything, and that's partly because our universe is screened, but it's also an aspect of our investment style. We think we can get the best return by knowing a few things really, really well, and that lends itself to areas like small caps and those sectors where we're going to be naturally overweight because of our ethical orientation. So things like IT, healthcare, renewable energy is where we spend a lot of effort. We get to know a lot of different companies, right from the micro cap or even the private level up to the very large level and sort of household names. And we hope that by being experts in those sectors that we can actually add value to your investments through time. And then some of the other factors there, you'd be familiar with other fund managers doing those sorts of activities around meeting companies and understanding industries in great detail. So I guess the proof of all this is in the pudding is, when you go and actually look, what does our portfolio look like at the end of the day? Does it just look like another ASX 300 sort of index fund with a nice overlay, or does it actually look like you're getting something different? And I certainly would argue for the latter. And these are some of the things that you'd expect a fund like this to be investing in. Up the top, IT, healthcare, utilities. You'd probably find that it was underweight some of the larger financials, underweight some of the mining and energy space, and overweight some of the emerging opportunities identified down below. So the question is, does our portfolio in fact look like that when the rubber hits the road? Here's on the left is the breakup of our portfolio in a pie chart, just showing how much of our portfolio was allocated to smaller and emerging and micro opportunities. You see it's about 53% versus around 11% for the ASX 300. So I think we get a tick on that score. On the next chart, again, if you look at sort of the sector breakdown, you can see in the case of healthcare, we have about twice as much healthcare as the ASX 300. We have, significantly more invested in IT. We also have a lot more invested in utilities and specifically hydro and wind energy rather than sort of coal-fired power. And in financials, you can see that, although we're roughly around a similar weight to the financials, we're certainly underweight the larger banks, and that's more allocated towards insurance and private health insurance and some of the smaller banks and second-tier banks, which we think meet our criteria. I'm actually responsible for the healthcare sector, and so I'm going to give you a few examples around investing in health and how we go about it. It's a significant part of our portfolio, probably always will be. even as valuations go up and down, one of the nice things about, and it's, I've got it on a dot point there, investing in the healthcare sector is it's not a homogenous sector. If you think about the different players in healthcare, you've got anything from health insurers to biotechnology companies to medical device makers to pathology companies to private hospitals. And so we've been able to find, even when specific companies might not meet our valuation criteria, through time we've been able to find other opportunities. And so it's a very important part of what we do. We've got quite a lot of depth in our team and understanding of different complex healthcare issues and systems. And we try to use that, you know, to make the wisest investments we can. So, you know, all up, it's about 15%. It certainly is a positive social impact sector. That's not always the case. Issues like animal testing are incredibly important to our investor base. And we really attack those issues head on with the CEOs of the companies that we invest in, and to a great level of depth. And we'll often go and interview, you know, the actual outsourced third party resources that those companies are using to do animal testing, and really try and understand that it's appropriate before we make an investment. But, you know, in general, healthcare is a positive impact sector for the overall community. Fortunately, it also has, you know, several positive economic tailwinds. Health has tended to grow above GDP. Several reasons for that is people get richer through time. They like to spend more money on healthcare. As people age, they tend to spend more money on healthcare. And the other sort of interesting factor is because there's new technology coming out in the healthcare space all the time, and often that technology is life-saving, it tends to be funded by governments. And so, you know, the next generation of pacemaker might cost five times the last generation, but there's some very strong arguments why that technology gets funded, and that's why we see, you know, the inexorable rise of healthcare spending. Of course, the problem with this is that not all economies can afford this, and that's where, I guess the key risk we identify investing in healthcare is government. Funnily enough, right now, it's not a bad time from the point of view of government risk. Certainly, government policy is being a bit kinder to healthcare as a sector, both here and overseas, than it has been in a while. And so from that perspective, we're quite comfortable. Probably the harder thing about investing in health at the moment is, like a lot of stocks with high growth profiles, they've done extremely well. And so we've got to be more and more creative in thinking how we get exposure to the sector without paying too much for particular investments. An example of a stock probably falls into that category is Fisher & Paykel Healthcare. It's a company we've held for a long time. We've been reducing our position because it's a really good company, but increasingly it trades at multiples that, you know, make it not as good value as it once was, although we do still continue to hold the stock. I'm not sure how many people are familiar with the company. It's a New Zealand-based company. It's been incredibly innovative, done extremely well over a long period of time. It really had a core platform of technology in humidification of invasive ventilation systems in hospitals. And somewhat uniquely for companies that I've covered, it sort of identified a growth path quite a long time ago and has really delivered on that growth path of innovating into new areas and also moving more and more away from selling hardware to selling the consumables that go with those machines. And one of the things we look for in companies is companies that have a recurring consumables revenue base. So it meets quite a few of the hurdles we look for. It's got a diverse portfolio, it's recurring earnings, attractive gross margin profile, and it's actually, it's got a new piece of technology which is really exciting in oxygen therapy. And it's actually developed a new platform around oxygen therapy, which delivers oxygen therapy at a higher rate. And this part of their business is becoming more and more meaningful and growing extremely quickly. And so when we look at Fisher & Paykel amongst the larger cap healthcare universe, we can see a very, very long runway of growth for this company. Now, of course, we've got to buy it at the right price. That's hard to do with a quality stock like this. We had an opportunity to add to our holdings last year when ResMed launched a piece of litigation against Fisher & Paykel, and the market became nervous. We added to our position, but as the stock's done well since then, we've been reducing that position. Another stock that we're interested in, Capital Health, a much smaller company, not as pretty, it's had a more checkered past, but one that appeals to us a bit more from a valuation perspective. We had the opportunity to buy about 6% of this company, and, you know, it is quite a small company, in a placement last year, and we got quite favourable terms on that, about 10% to where the share price was trading. The problem with the company is it had been on a big growth path. It had acquired assets, paid too much for them. Its cost base had got out of whack. And government policy it also hadn't really been helping them in terms of diagnostic imaging. And that's its core business, radiology or diagnostic imaging in the state of Victoria. We saw an opportunity for the company to repair its balance sheet and also to take cost out of the business and then to reorient some of its portfolio. So that's been a really good investment for us. In fact, what we've found is that diagnostic imaging, after not experiencing high growth for several years, is actually now growing quite quickly. It's one of the highest growing areas of healthcare. Share price has doubled. And then the company's actually done a few things that have really helped it continue on that journey. So although we sold some stock after the share price doubled, we've actually been buying back into the stock. And the reason is the company was able to start selling some of its portfolio at a very good price to other players in the industry. It took a lot of cost out and has now actually got net cash on the balance sheet. So, you know, at the end of the day, we're looking at a company in a high-growth industry, net cash on the balance sheet, reasonably benign environment for government intervention, although, you know, that's something certainly to watch, trading at an attractive multiple, and that's why we continue to add to our position in that stock. Talking about some of the earlier stage opportunities, this is an area, I guess, that's fraught with danger, investing certainly in the micro or emerging healthcare technology space. We kind of like that because it means there's opportunity. A lot of people won't look at this space. We've got people in our team that have looked at it for, you know, decades. And we take, we really try to manage risk very carefully when we're investing in this space. And that means that, you know, it's never going to be a big part of our portfolio, but it's certainly a part of the portfolio that can impact returns dramatically if you can add value in that space. We try to focus on quality science and things that have a reasonable amount of development under their belt rather than things that are more, you know, really just a science experiment. That's not the place where we play. We really interview companies very closely about their defined clinical, regulatory and commercial milestones. We want to see a clear path of news flow and development milestones for these companies. And we try to find companies that aren't just single product companies and at the same time aren't just reliant on a single investor or government agency for funding. So it's really important to us how companies think about managing their capital needs in the space as they grow, because even if they have a great product and they run out of money, often you're not going to end up a very happy investor. Once you can identify, you know, a company and you get to know it in this space, often we find that there's other companies that you might be able to play a similar theme, and you can use some of that investment knowledge. Here's a few examples of some of the companies we've invested in. Immutep is one we invested in a couple of months ago. They've just completed a successful capital raise. We're able to get in there on attractive terms. We co-invested in that deal with Platinum Investment. They're in this really hot area of immunotherapy in cancer. Obviously, it's a highly risky area. One of the things we like about this company, again, it's got multiple shots on goal. It actually has three established collaborations with major household pharmaceutical names like Merck, Novartis and GSK, and it's also running its own programs. But what that means is that if one of those particular programs falls over, it has other things that we think make it interesting, and it also has the ability to access funding from some of those companies because it has various milestone arrangements in place. And so we provided them with some more money to run some more trials. And certainly one of the investments that we're excited about, and they had a big piece of data that was out yesterday. Certex, that's obviously not an earlier stage company, but, you know, it's a great success story in Australian biotech. It's, you know, one of the most successful Australian biotech companies. It's had a real roller coaster of a ride, but ultimately what we've found is that offshore investors were prepared to pay a much higher price for that asset than what Australian investors were prepared to pay, or it looks as though they're going to pay that price. It's currently being worked out. PharmAccess is another company that's really had an up and down history. It was a very well known company previously and had a large market cap. Often we find opportunities in companies that have really changed their business models, but the market often thinks of them as the old company, when in fact they're something quite different. I think a bit of this applies to PharmAccess. It had a go in the respiratory disease indication, had a couple of products called Bronchitol and Aridol, which took a lot longer to get approved and cost a lot more money. In fact, one of them still not approved in the US. But that's not really what the company's about anymore. The company's actually pivoted into the emerging field of drug development in inflammation-based disease and liver disease particularly. We think it's got really, really good science in this area. Again, it's a small cap, you know, it's very small cap, it's a biotech company, but some of the major biotech investors around the world have been turning up on the balance sheet of Pharmaxis. And one of the things we've liked about it is because it has these, it's been able to do a major partnership with the global major Boehringer Ingelheim, that's helped fund its way while it does some of its own drug development work. So again, when we find a company that's been able to do a deal and fund itself, we think that takes some of the downside off the table investing in these sort of companies. And just finally, before I take some questions, here's the performance. We typically benchmark ourselves against the small industrials. We don't look like that much like any particular benchmark because we really construct the portfolio from the bottom up. But that's how the fund has done through time. So we're pleased with that performance. And that's really the end of the presentation. There's just a quote from our CEO, Phil Vernon, and happy to take some questions.